Comrade J, The Untold Secrets of Russia's Master Spy in America After the End of the Cold War, by Pete Earley. Narrated by Michael Prichard. Copyright 2007 by Pete Earley Incorporated. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Pete Earley and the Trident Media Group, and was produced in the year 2008 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Preface. This is a book I almost didn't write. It began with a telephone call from a lawyer who said he represented a Russian defector, a former intelligence officer, who wanted to tell his story. "What's his name?" I asked. "I'd rather not say on the phone." I'd been approached before by former Soviets. Most ex-KGB officers believed their life stories would make compelling reading, but few, if any, really did. "I'm sorry," I replied after a few more moments of evasive chatter. "I'm not interested." 2 months later, an FBI agent called. We'd first met when I was writing about Aldrich Ames, the CIA traitor responsible in the mid-1980s for the execution of at least 10 U.S. spies and the arrest of a dozen more. "You should talk to this defector," he explained. "He's read your book about Ames and really wants to meet you. Trust me, he's the real deal." I agreed, reluctantly. My FBI contact said he'd call me on a Thursday with details for a meeting. When Thursday arrived, he told me to drive to the Ritz-Carlton Hotel in Tysons Corner, Virginia, not far from CIA headquarters. Two FBI agents were in the lobby. They escorted me to a suite where snacks, soft drinks, and two CIA officers, who told me only their first names, were waiting. Seconds later, a tall, balding Russian, dressed in a well-tailored suit, entered from an adjoining room and extended his hand. "I'm Sergei Tretyakov," he announced. I suddenly understood why he merited a four-person joint FBI and CIA escort and a Ritz-Carlton rendezvous. He was not a Cold War leftover from the old KGB. His story was ripped from the front pages, the Boris Yeltsin and Vladimir Putin presidencies. Tretyakov had been a colonel in the SVR, Služba Vnezhnej Razvedky, the Russian Foreign Intelligence Service that replaced the KGB's overseas arm, before he disappeared with his wife Helen and their daughter Ksenia from the Russian residential compound in New York City. Although he vanished in October 2000, neither the U.S. nor the Russian government revealed his disappearance for nearly 4 months. In late January 2001, an unnamed State Department official told the Associated Press News Service that a Russian diplomat named Tretyakov had been granted asylum in the U.S. That tiny disclosure ignited a firestorm in Russia. Yevgeny Voronin, a deputy director in the Russian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, lambasted the State Department for telling the media about Tretyakov before it officially informed the Kremlin. Voronin said his government had been trying through diplomatic channels to learn about Tretyakov's whereabouts since October, but the U.S. had refused to even acknowledge that it knew the missing diplomat. Voronin demanded the U.S. arrange a face-to-face meeting between a Russian delegation and Tretyakov to ensure that neither he nor his family were coerced in any fashion and that they were okay. Without public comment, the State Department refused. A week later, the New York Times revealed that Tretyakov's diplomatic title, First Secretary in Press Relations at the Permanent Mission of the Russian Federation to the United States, had been a cover. The newspaper quoted unnamed U.S. sources saying Tretyakov was actually a top Russian intelligence officer. Because the U.S. and Russia were no longer considered formal adversaries, the Bush administration's decision to grant Tretyakov asylum suggested he was an extremely valuable catch for U.S. intelligence, the newspaper noted. Otherwise, the White House would not have risked irritating the Kremlin. The newspaper explained that the CIA had become selective about accepting defectors in its resettlement program because of the expense involved in relocating, protecting, and financially supporting them. But Tretyakov and his family had breezed through the process. Another tip-off that he was important. 3 weeks after the Times outed Tretyakov, the FBI arrested one of its own agents, Robert Philip Hansen. The 27-year FBI veteran was caught hiding stolen U.S. secrets in a suburban park near his home for the SVR to pick up later. The Washington Post and other newspapers speculated that Tretyakov had told the FBI about Hansen. But when then-FBI Director Louis J. Free was asked at a press conference about Tretyakov, the director refused to answer any questions about the mysterious defector. From that moment forward, Tretyakov went off the grid. Neither the FBI nor the CIA would answer questions about him or discuss his whereabouts. In Washington, a city infamous for leaks, there were no disclosures in shadowy parking garages by deep-throat sources. Tretyakov remained hidden, and the motive behind his defection and what he had done to merit asylum remained a top secret. Now Tretyakov and I were shaking hands in a glitzy hotel suite. Even more bizarre, our meeting had been arranged by the FBI and CIA. The two bureaucracies that had been carefully protecting his privacy for more than 4 years. During the next several hours, Tretyakov and I discussed his career, and it quickly became clear why I'd been told that he was the real deal. From April 1995 until October 2000, Tretyakov was the SVR's deputy resident in New York City, a second-in-command job that put him in charge of running all SVR intelligence day-to-day operations. Every SVR intelligence officer stationed in Manhattan reported directly to him, all 60 of them. He oversaw the handling of every foreign source working for Russian intelligence in Manhattan, more than 150 of them. And Tretyakov had personally directed every covert operation that the SVR had launched against the U.S. in the city. Put simply, he had been the SVR's go-to guy, the keeper of the Russian Foreign Intelligence Service's most cherished secrets. He knew the names of foreign diplomats spying for Russia inside the United Nations, and the identity of a Russian immigrant living in the U.S. who was delivering millions of dollars worth of stolen medical research to the SVR. During the coming months, I would discover an even more dramatic disclosure about Tretyakov that further explained why he was such a prized catch. Not only had he been a senior SVR intelligence officer, Tretyakov had worked for U.S. intelligence as a spy inside the Russian mission for at least 3 years before he defected, a fact that is being revealed only now in this book. He had stolen thousands of SVR top-secret diplomatic cables and hundreds of classified Russian intelligence reports. Sergei Tretyakov is the highest-ranking Russian intelligence officer ever to defect while stationed in the United States, a senior FBI agent involved in the case explained. This man literally held the keys to a Russian intelligence gold mine. What makes his story even more incredible is that he used those keys to unlock its doors and go into the mine every day to bring us nuggets. This book is an exposé. It reveals many of the Russian secrets that Tretyakov has disclosed to U.S. intelligence. In these pages, Tretyakov identifies UN diplomats who he claims spied for Russia during his stint as deputy resident. One of his more dramatic accusations is that Eldar Kuliev, a popular and well-known permanent representative to the UN from Azerbaijan in the 1990s, was secretly a deep-cover SVR intelligence officer. The president of Azerbaijan had no idea that his nation's ambassador was an undercover SVR officer, and neither did former U.S. Secretary of State Madeleine K. Albright, who frequently met with Kuliev. At the time, the Clinton administration was wooing Azerbaijan because of its rich oil reserves and its militarily strategic location. As a trusted confidant, Kuliev participated in sensitive meetings with Albright without the White House or his own government knowing he was reporting every conversation back to Moscow. In addition to accusing Ambassador Kuliev, Tretyakov identifies two other UN representatives as SVR spies. One still represents his government at the UN. The other currently serves as an ambassador to China. Tretyakov also claims that several UN diplomats who work for countries that are US allies and members of NATO are secretly Russian spies. He identifies them in these pages. But perhaps the most shocking disclosure that Tretyakov makes in this book is that the Russian Foreign Intelligence Service successfully embedded one of its deep cover officers inside the $64 billion oil for food program administered by the UN before Iraqi President Saddam Hussein was toppled. This Russian operative, working under the guise of being a diplomat, became a pivotal player in the UN humanitarian aid program and was able to use that position to help Russia steal millions of dollars that were supposed to be spent to help starving Iraqi women and children. Investigations by the UN and by US congressional committees already have revealed that nearly $500 million was diverted from the corrupt UN program into Russia. But Tretyakov's revelations, for the first time, provide a smoking gun that ties the SVR and the Kremlin directly to the UN thefts. He explains how Russian intelligence circumvented the UN's checks and balances system, and he reveals that when Russian President Vladimir Putin was told about the looting, rather than stopping it, he rewarded the deep cover SVR officer for his larceny by giving him one of Russia's highest medals. In yet another troubling disclosure, Tretyakov claims Russian intelligence targeted President Clinton's Deputy Secretary of State, Strobe Talbot, and ran a carefully calculated campaign designed to manipulate him. Talbot was the architect of U.S. policy toward Russia and its former republics during a crucial 7-year period after the Soviet Union breakup. According to Tretyakov, the SVR used Russia's then-Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs, Georgi Mamedov, to deceive and manipulate Talbot, in part by massaging his ego. Unbeknownst to Talbot, his Russian contact was a longtime co-optee, which meant Mamedov often did the bidding of Russian intelligence, Tretyakov said. In return, it helped promote Mamedov's diplomatic career. There was no reason for Talbot to suspect that Mamedov was acting as an SVR conduit. According to Tretyakov, the SVR prepared specific questions for Mamedov to ask Talbot during their private one-on-one conversations, including times when the two diplomats were socializing. Talbot considered Mamedov a friend and respected colleague. According to Tretyakov, the Russian diplomat used their personal relationship to glean information from Talbot that the SVR considered helpful to Russia. Talbot was shown a copy of Tretyakov's accusations before this book went to press. In a written response, Talbot called Tretyakov's interpretation of events erroneous and/or misleading. He wrote that he knew that Mamedov was relaying all of their conversations, including their private ones, back to Moscow. Talbot challenged Tretyakov to provide specifics and corroboration that showed he had been manipulated by Mamedov. There can be none, Talbot concluded, since what went on in my channel with Mamedov in fact advanced U.S. policy goals. Just the same, the FBI took the accusations about Talbot seriously when Tretyakov raised them after he began secretly helping the U.S. In 1999, FBI officials asked Secretary Albright not to share information with Talbot about an ongoing espionage investigation at the State Department because its agents were afraid he might inadvertently tip off the SVR through Mamedov. according to private and published sources. Tretyakov said the SVR considered Mamadov's handling of Talbot so clever that Russian intelligence identified the senior American diplomat in correspondence and classified internal reports as a special, unofficial contact, a specific term that the SVR used to identify its most secret, highly placed intelligence sources. Of course, when Tretyakov and I first met in the Ritz-Carlton Hotel, I did not know about any of these revelations, or that he had spied for the U.S. At the time, I was cautious about speaking to him. Why, after 4 years of keeping Tretyakov hidden, were the FBI and CIA suddenly willing to let him talk openly? When I raised this question, my FBI contact said, "Our only purpose here today is to introduce you. We are not encouraging him to tell his story, nor are we discouraging him. He wanted to meet you, and we agreed to facilitate it. We will have no part in your talks." Even so, I remained skeptical. Sources always have a motive when they speak to reporters. Few do it purely out of goodness. But I decided to put aside my concerns about the FBI and CIA and concentrate on Tretyakov. I asked him that afternoon if he expected to be paid for telling his story, because cash traditionally is what most former KGB spies are after. "I don't care about money," he replied. "No publisher alive has enough money to pay me for what I know. I am worth millions because I am Russian intelligence." I later learned the U.S. government had already set him up financially for the rest of his life. Moving down my checklist, I asked if he was seeking fame. "Of course I want people to know what I have done. However, most Americans can't pronounce Tretyakov, nor will they remember the name longer than a few seconds. So this, too, doesn't concern me." I told him there was a difference between paying a ghostwriter to write his story and being interviewed by a reporter. A journalist would try, as best he could, to investigate all his accusations. Tretyakov smiled. "I do not want to be the author. It will be your book to write, not mine." If Sergei wasn't interested in money, didn't care about fame, and was eager to waive any editorial rights to a book, then what was he after? "I want to warn Americans. As a people, you are very naive about Russia and its intentions. You believe because the Soviet Union no longer exists, Russia now is your friend. It isn't. And I can show you how the SVR is trying to destroy the U.S. even today, and even more than the KGB did during the Cold War." Continuing, he said, "My wife, Helen, and I are from families that were extreme patriots. We were taught to be proud of our homeland. We were members of the Soviet party elite. We were apparatchiki, people who were part of the Communist Party apparatus. In Moscow, we had a luxury apartment worth more than $1 million. We had 2 summer houses. I was feared and respected by the officers under my command. I was going to be promoted to the rank of general after I returned from Manhattan to Moscow. But Helen and I decided to leave everything behind us. All of that. We brought nothing really with us when we defected, only what we could carry in 2 tiny suitcases. This was intentional on our parts. My wife and I know our friends and former colleagues in Moscow are asking, why? Why did Sergei and Helen do this? How could they turn away from their motherland? They want to know why we would walk away and leave all of this wealth and property and privilege behind. I want to explain my decision. Our decision. Every man who is born in one country and who later turns away from his native land and actively works to help its enemies seems compelled to explain his actions. I had witnessed this twice before. My first book was about John Walker, Jr. and his family of spies. A former naval officer, Walker became a KGB spy in 1968 during the height of the Cold War and recruited his best friend, his brother, and his own son to join him as traitors. During our jailhouse talks, Walker spent hours justifying his actions. Because the U.S. and Soviet Union were not at war, he claimed, his treason had not damaged U.S. interests. If anything, his willingness to sell U.S. military secrets to the KGB had helped the Kremlin realize that its military forces were inferior, and how pointless it was to continue spending billions to challenge an overwhelming U.S. military. The CIA traitor Aldrich Ames wrote me long, detailed letters filled with rationalizations for his treason when I was writing about him. Much like Walker, he insisted nothing that he had compromised had harmed U.S. interests. While regrettable, the KGB's decision to execute 10 FBI and CIA sources was part of the spy versus spy game. Each executed spy had known he was putting himself in harm's way, just as Ames had recognized that his decision to betray the U.S. had placed him in jeopardy. The dead men's blood was on their own hands, not his. It was not surprising, then, that Tretyakov wanted to explain himself. Our initial meeting that Thursday afternoon led to more and longer sessions that eventually stretched out well over a year. These tape-recorded interviews were done at Tretyakov's home without the FBI or CIA being present. And Tretyakov kept his word. He never interfered with my research or tried to take control of the writing of this book. Although Tretyakov defected in October 2000, many of his disclosures are incredibly fresh in the intelligence world. The SVR still has not had time to change many of the technical devices and procedures that it uses in New York City and elsewhere, according to FBI sources familiar with Tretyakov's case. Several of the SVR officers and their spies, whom Tretyakov describes in these pages, are still working in New York. Several Russian officials identified in this book can be spotted on nightly news broadcasts from the Kremlin. Tretyakov's career spanned both the old KGB system and the post-Soviet era, giving him a unique vantage point and the ability to compare and judge if the reforms brought on by the end of the old Soviet system have made a difference in Russian intelligence gathering today. The more time I spent with Tretyakov, the more I realized he was telling me two stories. He was revealing top secrets about how Russian intelligence operates in Manhattan. And he was telling me a personal story. Tretyakov had been groomed to become a KGB officer. He'd received the best possible education the Soviet system offered its intelligence agents. He'd been an enthusiastic Communist Party member and a willing participant in the nomenklatura, the communist system of rewarding people in political favor. Although he attempted to distance himself in interviews from the cruelty inflicted by the KGB, explaining that he spent his entire career inside the first chief directorate, foreign intelligence, and never in the directorate that persecuted dissidents, Tretyakov was still part of a bureaucracy that brutalized its own people. The KGB exploited anyone who might be useful. Husbands spied on their wives, children on their parents, neighbors on neighbors. Tretyakov was a cog in that oppressive regime, regardless of where he hung his hat at work. He had closed his eyes to the blood being spilled around him like so many Russians had. And like them, Tretyakov came to support the changes of glasnost, public discussion of issues, and perestroika, President Mikhail Gorbachev's campaign to revitalize the nation. In December 1991, when the Soviet Union ceased to exist, Tretyakov celebrated its demise and looked forward to the construction of a more democratic country. But he soon became bitter about what he witnessed, and he ultimately became so disillusioned that he silently rejected Russia's leaders, decided to betray his native land, and ultimately defected to a nation that was its most hated rival. This book exposes secrets told by a top Russian intelligence officer who had access to information denied his countrymen. This book also describes an odyssey, a personal story about the disillusionment of a former Soviet patriot and the reasons he put his life and that of his family at risk by becoming a spy for the United States. Part 1. Born a Communist. Give us the child for 8 years, and it will be a Bolshevik forever. Vladimir Ulyanov Lenin, 1870-1924, founder, Russian Communist Party. Chapter 1. April 1995. Sergei and Helen didn't look back when the Aeroflot jet lifted off from Sheremetyevo Airport en route to New York City. Neither was sad to be leaving Moscow. Only Sergei's mother still tied them to Russia. Now in her 70s, Revmira continued to live by herself in the family's spacious apartment on Frunzenskaya Street, across from the Moscow River, near Gorky Park. Even though Sergei had never lived in the U.S., his years of working in the North American department of the old KGB, and months of pre-departure briefings at SVR headquarters, known simply as the Center, made him feel as if he were going home. In Manhattan, the Russian government operated from three buildings. The most ornate was the Russian consulate at 9 East 91st Street. The most out of the way was the Russian living compound at 355 West 255th Street in the Bronx. The most important was the Russian permanent mission to the United Nations at 136 East 67th Street. The Russians also owned two estates on Long Island, a 49-room house in Glen Cove, and a second mansion in Oyster Bay. The Glen Cove residence was used only by the ambassador and his top deputies. The Oyster Bay mansion could be used by others, including the SVR resident, who had a suite with a private balcony in one of its wings. The resident often entertained visiting SVR generals there. The Russian consulate was within walking distance of Central Park and easy to spot. A Russian flag dangled from a pole above its entrance, and there was usually a line of applicants on the sidewalk waiting to apply for visas. Helen had been offered a job at the consulate working as a clean secretary, which meant her job would have nothing to do with the SVR or GRU. Glavnoe Razvedivatelnoe Upravlenie, which was Russian military intelligence. Eventually, the couple's only daughter, Ksenia, also would work there. Whenever possible, the Russian government hired spouses and children of its diplomats to fill posts overseas, rather than flying employees in from Russia. The consulate had a handful of SVR intelligence officers working inside it under diplomatic cover. Most were from Line N, illegals. They copied or simply stole U.S. documents from persons applying for travel visas and other Russian travel papers. The U.S. documents, passports, birth certificates, etc., were sent to the center, where they were either duplicated or altered slightly before being issued to illegals. SVR intelligence officers who entered the U.S. surreptitiously, often posing as Eastern European immigrants. Illegals needed the counterfeit identification papers to buttress fake backgrounds, legends in spy parlance, and hide their true identities. The officers were part of the SVR's underground, invisible network. They tried to become U.S. citizens, marry Americans, and find jobs working for the U.S. government or some other political or military organization that could prove useful to the SVR. Clerks at the consulate were trained to tell U.S. citizens who complained about their identification papers disappearing that they had been misplaced or lost. The Russian residential compound was in the Bronx, which extends from the Hudson River to Long Island Sound and is the northernmost of New York City's five boroughs. The complex was edged by a chain-link security fence that encircled some smaller buildings and a 20-story apartment house. It jutted up awkwardly from a neighborhood of modest, two-story, older brick homes in a neighborhood called Riverdale, where Mark Twain and Theodore Roosevelt had once lived. Constructed in the early 1970s, the facade was devoid of decoration and had been built as cheaply as possible by Soviet laborers from Moscow. Not long after it was completed, one of its sides had started to break free from the rest of the structure. Engineers pulled it back in place by bolting thick steel cables to the failing wall and anchoring them to the center of the building. Holes for the cables had been punched through walls without any thought about tenants. Some rooms on the upper floors had steel lines shooting through them at eye level, forcing tenants to duck whenever they walked through the rooms. In a short-sighted move, U.S. officials approved the sale of the Riverdale land to the Soviet Union without realizing how strategic its location was for spying. The high rise was built on a steep hill that was one of the tallest points in the city. Concealed under wooden boxes on the building's flat roof were dozens of antennas designed to snatch signals and conversations from New York City's airwaves. Similar antennas could be found on the roof of the Russian permanent mission in Manhattan. These two listening posts were part of a sophisticated surveillance system called Post Impulse that was operated by Line VKR, Foreign Counterintelligence. The SVR used the rooftop stations to survey a swath of 40 miles, intercepting police broadcasts, cell phone calls, and other communications throughout Manhattan and much of Long Island and New Jersey. Over time, the SVR and GRU had been able to identify and lock onto signals from every law enforcement operation in the area. They used the signals to keep track of the location of FBI agents and other officers. If the Russians saw that several FBI agents were in the same vicinity as one of their SVR officers, they knew he was being followed. The computers and other devices used by Post Impulse were housed on the building's 19th floor, which was off-limits to everyone except SVR officers and their sources. It served as the SVR's second residency, with its primary headquarters being housed in the 67th Street Mission. The tenants referred to the living compound simply as Riverdale. Sergei was required to live there so he could be close to the second residency. The hallway ceilings were covered with asbestos. The walls were dingy and needed painting. Sergei had been assigned a two-room apartment on the 10th floor. As deputy resident, he could have demanded one of the three-room units that were being used by larger families. But he didn't like to take advantage of his rank. The main room of Sergei's apartment would serve as a combination living and dining area with a kitchenette. Because of the long hours he would be working, often late at night, Sergei would sleep on a pull-out couch in the front room, leaving Helen and Ksenia to share the bedroom. It was barely large enough for a double bed. A tiny bathroom was in a corner. There was one closet. The walls of the apartments were hollow, and the odors from different kitchens frequently permeated the hallways. Neighbors could hear whatever was being said next door, and it was not uncommon to walk down a hallway at night and hear a squabble or sounds of lovemaking. Riverdale's ground floor had a reception area and a concert room used for diplomatic functions. A small bar, where liquor and hot sandwiches were served, and a grocery store, where prices were kept artificially low, were on the second floor. Cigarettes that sold for $30 per carton in New York could be bought for $10. Booze was one-tenth the Manhattan price. It was illegal for Russians to resell items from the store outside the living compound. The third and fourth floors were taken up by a school and a medical clinic. Teachers and doctors from Russia were flown in after undergoing extensive background investigations. Hiring preferences were given to Russians who had relatives at home because those family ties reduced the risk of defections. Riverdale had an underground parking garage and a swimming pool. Sergei had been issued a mid-size Mercury sedan to drive. His rank-and-file SVR officers drove Ford Taurus models. The lowest employees stationed in the U.S. got the keys to a Ford Focus. Even though Riverdale had a permanent ant and cockroach infestation that exterminators couldn't seem to eliminate, and the apartments were in shabby condition, few Russians asked for permission to live elsewhere. Cost was the main reason. Sergei's rent was $100 per month. Russia's permanent representative to the United Nations, who held the same rank as an ambassador serving in an embassy overseas, was not expected to live in Riverdale. In April 1995, the representative was Sergei Lavrov, a seasoned diplomat who would later become the Russian Minister of Foreign Affairs under President Putin. Ambassador Lavrov was constantly changing apartments in Manhattan, paying as much as $30,000 per month in rent and moving from one part of the city to another, Sergei would later recall. He was required to alert the SVR each time he moved, so our technical experts could make certain his apartment was free of FBI listening devices. But Lavrov was moving without telling us, and I suspect he was more afraid and concerned about SVR bugs than he was about anything the Americans might hide in his apartment. In addition to Ambassador Lavrov, Russians who worked for the United Nations Secretariat were also expected to live away from Riverdale because they were UN employees and supposed to be impartial and keep an arm's-length relationship with their native country. Just the same, most of these Russians socialized at the Riverdale bar and bought commodities at its store. The SVR's headquarters, called the Residentura, was located inside the permanent mission of the Russian Federation to the United Nations at East 67th Street, between Lexington and 3rd Avenues. Located across the street from a synagogue and a fire station, there was nothing about the mission's 12-story office building that made it stand out. The only sign that identified it was a plaque near the main entrance. A guard was posted there, but none of the security officers inside the mission were armed, and surprisingly, no firearms were kept there, according to Sergei. Instead, the building was protected by a series of electronically deadbolted doors and video cameras. If a guard at the entrance needed help with an unruly protester or came under attack, the mission staff called 911. Clean diplomats and other office personnel employed by the Russian Ministry of Foreign Affairs used the mission's lower five floors. The 9th through the 12th floors contained several large residential apartments. Ambassadors from former Soviet republics, such as the Ukraine and Georgia, had occupied these units before the breakup of the USSR. Now that those republics had their own independent missions elsewhere in New York, the apartments had been rented to Ambassador Lavrov's top deputies, with one exception. The representative from Tajikistan still lived there. The SVR resident, Sergei's direct boss, also had an apartment in the building, so he could be close to the Residentura and its communications center. There was one other group of Russians who were required to reside inside the mission, but their units were much different from the spacious apartments that housed the diplomats and the SVR station chief. Code clerks, the foreign intelligence employees responsible for encrypting and deciphering secret cables, were crowded into a tiny area near the communications center. During the Cold War, the clerks had been held much like prisoners in the mission because the KGB did not want to risk having one of them defect or be recruited to spy. In those days, KGB security officers met the clerks and their families at the airport, drove them to the building, and literally kept them locked inside it until they were scheduled to return to Russia. They were then driven to the airport under guard and put on an airplane. The SVR had lifted many of the KGB's tight security restrictions placed on code clerks, but their living conditions in New York remained grim. There were four families with children sharing one tiny bathroom and one small kitchen in the mission, Sergei said. I remember one of the wives coming to me and saying, "My dream is to one day have a stove where I can use more than one burner." The 6th, 7th, and 8th floors of the mission were heavily protected and classified as top secret. The 6th was where the permanent representative and Russia's senior diplomatic corps worked. The 7th was used by code clerks. And the 8th housed the SVR and GRU residenturas. It was nicknamed the submarine because of the extraordinary security precautions that had been taken when it was built. A special technical team had flown into Manhattan from Moscow to customize the entire floor. The team attached hundreds of heavy springs to the bare concrete, covering the floor, walls, and ceiling. An entirely new and separate structure had then been built on top of the springs so that none of the interior surfaces touched the concrete building. This new interior floated inside the original. The walls of the submarine were several inches thick and had a core made of sheet metal. Its joints had been welded and checked with an X-ray machine for microscopic cracks. To further shield the submarine, KGB technicians had combed its walls with a spider net of wires that constantly vibrated, emitting a white noise that reminded Sergei of the buzzing that comes from a cheap electric transformer attached to a toy railroad set. Sergei once asked an SVR doctor if the constant noise could harm a man's hearing. The doctor had said no, but Sergei hadn't believed him and would later claim that he often could still hear the noise buzzing in his head. The extra-thick walls caused the interior ceilings to be a foot shorter than others inside the mission. There were no windows in the submarine, no phone lines connecting it to the outside world, and the computers inside it did not have access to the Internet. Even the floor's electricity and ventilation system were self-contained to prevent tampering by outsiders. The lion's share of the submarine was used by the SVR, with the remainder going to the GRU. But the two residenturas were completely independent, and neither had access to the others. The ambassador was the only clean diplomat in the mission with access to the submarine. After an SVR officer passed through various checkpoints in the mission's lower floors, he would take an elevator or stairs to an 8th-floor lobby that had 2 steel doors. Neither had any identifying signs. One was used by the SVR, the other by the GRU. The SVR's door had a brass plate and knob, but there was no keyhole. To open the door, the head of the screw in the lower right corner of the brass plate had to be touched with a metal object, such as a wedding ring or a coin. The metal would connect the screw to the brass plate, completing an electrical circuit that would snap open the door's bolt lock and sometimes shock the person holding the coin. The door opened into a small cloakroom. No jackets or suit coats were allowed inside the residentura because they could be used to conceal documents and hide miniature cameras. SVR officers left their coats, cell phones, portable computers, and all other electronic devices in lockers. A camera videotaped everyone who entered the cloakroom. It was added after several officers discovered someone had stolen money from wallets left in jackets. Another solid steel door with a numeric lock that required a 4-digit code to open led from the cloakroom into the residentura. A male secretary sat near the door and kept track of who entered, exited, and at what times. A hallway to the left led to the main corridor, which was 90 feet long and had offices along either side. Because the New York residentura was one of the largest and most important in the SVR, it contained all of the SVR's lines, departments. They were line OT, technical operations, line N, illegals, line ER, economic intelligence, line RP, radio interception, line X, science and technology, line VKR, foreign counterintelligence, and line PR, political intelligence, which was the biggest and the most important. Residents were always from line PR. The residentura also contained a file room called System Contact, with 1.5 million microfiche cards. Most of the information on the cards was about Americans. There was a photo room on the floor, too. The SVR did not send written reports by its officers to the center in diplomatic pouches. Instead, it photographed each report and sent the film to the center to be developed and printed. Unless a document had some apparent future value, it was destroyed after it was photographed. A limousine driver from the mission was waiting at JFK Airport when Sergei, Helen, and Ksenia landed from their Moscow flight. As soon as the two women were settled at Riverdale, Sergei left for the mission. Because of the seriousness of his job, he was stone-faced and all business. But he felt as excited as a boy attending his first day of school. At age 38, Sergei was the youngest deputy resident ever sent to New York. Yet he was completely confident. He had spent his entire professional career preparing for this assignment, and he was eager to begin matching wits with the FBI and CIA. As a child, Sergei had gone to bed dreaming of a day when he would become a KGB officer battling against the motherland's Glavny Protivnik, main adversary, the United States. He had come a long way since those youthful fantasies when he was tucked safely in his bed on Frunzenskaya Street, and his career had taken several unexpected twists and turns. But his moment had finally arrived. When he touched a coin on the door that led into the mission's submarine and heard the deadbolt slide open, Sergei did not hesitate. Chapter 2. October 1956. From birth, the KGB seemed to flow through Sergei Tretyakov's veins. His maternal grandmother, Lyubov Yonina, was the source. During World War II, she supervised a secretarial pool in the People's Commissariat for Internal Affairs, NKVD, the forerunner of the KGB. Lyubov and 25 typists worked exclusively for Lavrenty Pavlovich Beria, the infamous director of the secret police who oversaw the final stages of the Great Purge of the 1930s. Some 1.7 million Russians were arrested during Joseph Stalin's campaign of terror. 700,000 were executed. Lyubov worked within the Kremlin's walls in a secret bunker, and she would describe an incident there to her family that said much about Beria and the times. The story would be repeated in hushed sentences. According to Grandmother Lyubov, Beria appeared one morning in the bunker and announced that he needed help. "Girls," he said, "yesterday I gave a typed report to Comrade Stalin. I have forgotten what it said. Who typed this report, and can you tell me, please, what it was about?" No one stirred, and then a young typist rose from her chair and said, "Oh, Comrade Beria, it was me. I typed it, and I can recall every word for you." The next day, the girl disappeared. Lyubov and the others got the message. Their job was to type documents, but not read them or dare remember what they contained. Lyubov always finished her story with the same warning. "It's best in our country to never ask questions and to have a very poor memory." Lyubov knew Stalin personally, and even though she never held a top military rank, she rose higher in the secret police than most other women at the time. Flamboyant and independent, Lyubov married four times, but bore only one child, a daughter, whom she named Revmira, which is an abbreviation for World Revolution. She treated her child as a contemporary. As soon as Revmira was old enough, she went to work in the financial office of the KGB. At night, mother and daughter would stop for drinks in a private KGB club next door to Lubyanka, the Soviet secret security headquarters in downtown Moscow. Revmira met Oleg Tretyakov, the man whom she would later marry, at a nightclub. His background was much different from hers. Prior to the 1917 revolution, the Tretyakov family had been aristocrats. Tsar Nicholas II had declared Oleg's father an honored citizen of Russia. But the Bolsheviks stripped the family of its titles and wealth, and by the time that Oleg was born in 1921, the family was destitute. On the first day of World War II, Oleg joined the Soviet army, and when Germany invaded Russia in 1941, he was sent to the front. Oleg was twice wounded before he was transferred to Russia's eastern border. Stalin believed a Japanese attack was imminent, but it never happened. Meanwhile, Oleg's comrades in the West were slaughtered by German troops. Russia suffered more military and civilian casualties during the war than any country, some 20 million. The Russian soldiers who survived were declared heroes and awarded privileges. Oleg was told he could enroll in any Moscow university. He selected a mining institute because it gave students uniforms, and he didn't have enough money to buy a change of clothes. After graduation, he was sent to work in the Soviet Union's secret atomic weapons program. It was during this period that Oleg and Revmira met and married. In 1956, their only child, Sergei Tretyakov, was born. At work, Oleg handled uranium, and he received a lethal dose one day. Incredibly, he survived, cheating death for a second time. But his days at the lab were over. He was sent to the Soviet Ministry of Foreign Trade, and within a year dispatched to Iran as a trade representative. Like all Soviets who were allowed to live overseas, he was required to report to the KGB. "My father never loved the KGB," Sergei would later recall. "He called it a nest of morons and idiots. But he was practical and accepted being part of it because, in return, he was able to travel and live overseas." In the 1960s, Iran was run by Mohammad Reza Pahlavi, the Shah of Iran, and was the world's second largest oil producer. Its capital, Tehran, was a modern city, and the Tretyakov family took advantage of their pro-Western surroundings. "My father was passionate about jazz. In the Soviet Union, jazz was considered poisonous and was banned," Sergei said. "But in Iran, my father introduced me to all of the great jazz. He was a huge fan of Hollywood movies, too, and we saw every new movie and had access to American culture. My mother constantly criticized my father because she said I was supposed to live in the Soviet world, not the Western one. But my father didn't care. 'Our son must be raised on the absolute best standards,' he would reply, 'not on the bullshit that is called Soviet music and Soviet movies.' Of course, this became a paradox for me because my father was a passionate patriot. He loved his country and was an active member in the Communist Party. Yet I knew growing up that he never believed that communism was a superior idea. We lived abroad, and all of us could see with our own eyes how people lived better lives outside Russia than our comrades back home." When Sergei turned 9, his father sent him back to Russia to complete his schooling and become Sovietized. He was placed under the care of Aunt Shura, a nanny who treated him, in his own words, "as if I were a little prince." One day, Revmira arrived unannounced at the family's Moscow apartment just as her son was about to eat. Sergei didn't see her, but he did notice that he didn't have a napkin, so he snapped his fingers and declared, Napkin, please. Aunt Shura was scrambling to fetch one for him when Revmira slapped her son on the back of his head and told him to get a napkin for himself. My mother was the ultimate general in our household and outside it, too. She wasn't afraid of anyone, even the KGB. She knew important people and she knew how to use the system. She was brilliant, and I listened to her every word. To me, she became everything. Sergei had trouble at school. Other Moscow students were envious of his family's status and affluence. The best and most important jobs in the Soviet Union were held exclusively by party members. Out of a population of 300 million, only 18 million were allowed in the party. A youngster had to study for several years and pass a background check to be inducted. Because of his family's KGB connections, Sergei was on track. At age 7, he'd become a Son of October, which was the first step. At age 10, he became a young pioneer. 4 years later, he would be eligible to join the Komsomol, which was the Young Communist League. He would then be well prepared to apply for party membership by his mid-20s. In elementary school, other students bullied him. They took whatever rubles he had. He didn't tell anyone. But his mother noticed during one of her visits from Iran that Sergei's face was bruised. She got him to tell her what was happening, and then she became angry. At him. She arranged for her son to take boxing lessons. "Don't be an idiot," she lectured. "You're a big boy. Fight back. Hit them as hard as you can in their heads with anything you can. If you don't, you will get a second beating when you come home." The next time Sergei was preyed on, he fought. Almost overnight, he went from being a victim to becoming a bully. Teenage thugs in his neighborhood eventually gave him a nickname, Small, out of respect because he was big for his size and had become one of them. The police called him in for questioning about several fistfights. As soon as Revmira learned what was happening, she jerked Sergei out of his tough neighborhood school and put him in a more prestigious one. He stayed there 5 years. But a month before graduation, the principal threatened to expel him because Sergei had started bullying other students again. This time, Revmira used her connections to enroll Sergei in what was arguably the city's most elite academy. "I discovered that a person could do whatever he wished in Moscow, without fear of consequences, if he had the right connections. My mother had those connections, and she enrolled me in an academy that was filled with total idiots. The education was less than zero, but it didn't matter because my classmates were the children of the most powerful Communist Party members, the nomenklatura. This meant they could get by without doing anything. No work at all. Fortunately, I had already received an excellent education in my previous school. I had read all of the classic Russian, English, American, German, and French literature as a teenager. Without those fundamentals, I would have been a complete imbecile because I was much more interested in chasing girls and getting into trouble with friends than my studies." Sergei was accepted into the Moscow Institute of Foreign Languages, the second-best university in the Soviet Union. Only years later would he learn that the Department of Interpreters, which was the group that accepted him, was financed entirely by the KGB. It used the department to identify promising recruits. Sergei's willingness to bully his classmates and his parents' strong KGB and Communist Party connections had made him someone the KGB wanted to watch. Chapter 3. "You know, our children get along quite well. What would you think about them getting married?" Revmira was speaking about Sergei. She and Oleg had returned to Moscow, but were scheduled to leave for another tour in Iran, and she was worried about leaving her immature son behind. Now 19, Sergei was barely passing his university classes. Revmira knew it was because he was socializing rather than studying. Her solution was to find him a wife. She telephoned Valentina Nikolaevna Strunkina, whose granddaughter, Yelena Helen Mikhailovna, had caught Sergei's eye. Sergei had gone out with lots of girls, and Revmira had disliked all of them except for Helen. She was a year older than Sergei and was an excellent student at the Soviet Union's most prestigious university, the Moscow State Institute of International Relations. She lived with her grandmother because her parents were divorced and both had remarried and started new lives. A friend introduced them, and Helen had been instantly enamored. Sergei hadn't asked for her telephone number, however, and she assumed that he wasn't interested. A few days after they met, she spotted him walking his Scottish terrier outside her apartment building. He didn't live nearby, and she noticed he was circling the block. So she stepped onto her balcony and asked him what he was doing. He acted surprised, pretended that he was in her neighborhood by chance, and invited her to join him on his walk. After that, they became serious. The phone call to Helen's grandmother came 3 months later. "If you agree with my idea," Revmira told the older woman, "I will send Sergei over to propose to Helen this afternoon." "I like Sergei very much," Grandmother Valentina Nikolaevna replied, "and Helen's father likes him too, and so does Helen. So we have nothing against a marriage." A few hours later, Sergei obediently knocked on Helen's door. "Helen," he said, "I don't know how to propose this, but my mother wants us to get married." "Well," she replied, "your mother is a very smart woman. So if she wants us to get married, then let's get married." They got a license and had a civil ceremony. Because the families weren't certain if the marriage would last, Sergei and Helen promised not to have children for several years. A photograph of the newlyweds shows an attractive couple. He is fit, tall, with blue eyes, a mop of blonde hair, a confident smile, and a round Russian face. She is petite, with shoulder-length dark blonde hair, porcelain skin, and a shy glint in her eyes. Like Sergei's father, Helen's had fought and been wounded during World War II, even though he was technically too young to join the army. Mikhail Pavlovich Tulisov had lied about his age. During fighting on the Western Front, he was wounded and half buried in mud after a cannon round exploded near him. His commanding officer sent word to Mikhail's parents in Moscow, telling them that their son was dead. But when another soldier began tugging off the 17-year-old's boots the next morning, Mikhail's toes twitched, and his comrades dug him out of the muck. After the war, Mikhail studied diplomacy in Moscow, which is where he met Helen's mother, Kira Dmitrievna Strunkina, a stunningly beautiful but vain woman who was being pursued by several suitors. Mikhail impressed her by tossing one of her boyfriends off a bridge into the Moscow River during a jealous confrontation. Mikhail and Kira married and lived in Poland, where he worked as a cultural attaché at the embassy. Helen grew up there. But her parents divorced as soon as they returned to Moscow, leaving their teenage daughter to live with her grandmother. Sergei's parents felt comfortable leaving their son behind as soon as he married Helen. With her help, Sergei's grades improved. Helen, meanwhile, graduated at the top of her class and went to work as a senior economist at the Ministry of Foreign Trade. Not long after that, Helen and Sergei were admitted into the Communist Party. Without warning, a KGB officer telephoned their apartment one afternoon and asked Sergei to meet him at the Hotel Centralnaya, one of the city's best-known hotels. Sergei was told to arrive at the entrance at exactly 11 a.m. and wait for a man carrying a newspaper. Sergei did as instructed, and a stranger holding a paper led him upstairs into one of the rooms. After flashing his KGB credentials, the man announced that the KGB had been watching Sergei. "We know everything," he declared. "We know your family background, how you were a bully and poor student. We know about your marriage, and based on what we have observed, we are considering you as a possible candidate for our service." "Why me?" Sergei asked. "The KGB doesn't explain anything," the man snapped, Just do as you are told and understand that if this door opens for you, it is a great honor. And if you walk through it and it closes behind you, then there is no way out. You belong to our organization forever. The man said the KGB had an assignment for him. It wanted him to go on a student exchange to France that was being planned by one of his teachers. The KGB asked him to spy on his fellow students and any French college professors the group would meet. It was 1978, and the Cold War was hot. "But my teacher already said I would not be allowed to go on the trip," Sergei replied. "She doesn't like me, and she said the only way for me to travel would be over her dead body." "Just do what you are told," the man lectured. "We will take care of the teacher." When Sergei arrived at class the next day, his teacher rushed up and in a scared voice said, "You are on the top of the list to go to France." Sergei was thrilled. He'd wanted to join the KGB since childhood, had read countless spy books and watched every James Bond movie. Helen was happy, too, because she felt the KGB would be a good career choice for her new husband. Because Sergei's mother had worked for the KGB, she approved. Even his father, who had a low opinion of KGB officers, thought it was a good idea. "It's better to drink blood than eat rabbit food," Oleg advised his son, explaining that in a repressive society, being an oppressor is superior to being a victim. 26 students left for France on the university exchange trip. Sergei suspected that he wasn't the only one who'd been asked to spy. The KGB had told him that Stanislav Rudin, an older participant on the trip, was its official contact. Not long after they arrived in France, Rudin took Sergei aside and suggested that he write daily reports about his spying on toilet paper. 24 hours later, Rudin hustled Sergei into a public toilet and asked for his report. They stood next to each other, and after Rudin read each sheet of toilet paper, he dropped it into a urinal and peed on it so the ink would become unreadable. Sergei later recalled his reaction. "I thought, what kind of stupid organization is this? But I decided it was this man who was a total moron, not the entire KGB." Sergei knew his actions were being watched. "The KGB wanted to see how willing I was to inform on my fellow students. If you were too enthusiastic, it wasn't good because it showed you had no character. But if you didn't report anything, that meant you were lazy. The KGB never wanted the best or the brightest students, nor did it want the dumb or lazy ones. It wanted well-balanced prospects. There was a KGB saying, a heart must be in the center of the body, and the men the KGB recruited had to be in the center." Midway through the French tour, a student named Vladimir Kozlov was caught stealing a women's bra in a store. The teacher in charge of the students claimed that Kozlov was the victim of a provocation, a trap set by the gendarmerie, the French military police, to embarrass the Soviet Union. But none of the students believed her. Kozlov had taken the bra because he wanted to be arrested. Once he was in French custody, he could defect. Although Kozlov was detained at the clothing store by a clerk, the French police did not arrest him. He was released to the tour group, and the KGB began looking for a quiet way to get Kozlov back home before he tried another stunt. Sergei was ordered to befriend Kozlov and persuade him to go on a train for a 6-hour ride to a remote station. Once there, the KGB would grab Kozlov and fly him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.